guys, welcome back to my channel. This video is going to be about how much it cost me for a master's degree in the UK. Guys, I've been requesting this video for a really long time, so it was finally time I made this. I'm going to be sharing everything it cost me, everything from the plane tickets, visas, accommodation, groceries, everyday costs up until now. Now, there can be more costs in the future. I'm sorry, but I might have to wear my glasses for a little bit because I cannot see the screen properly. Also, I'm going to make a detailed video on accommodation in the future, so make sure that you subscribe and turn on the notification bell. And if you haven't already, then make sure that you check out my study abroad guide, which I posted last week. I'll just put the link right here on the iCard as well as in the description. You can just go on my channel and check that out. First thing that you have to do is to take the exams, which is the IELTS exam, which is like almost mandatory if your native language is not English, which cost me, to be exact, 16,250 rupees, which is the Indian rupees, which is equivalent to 160 pounds approximately, because like the values keep fluctuating every day. So this is the amount which cost me today, as in the day I'm filming this video, but it could differ when you're watching it. You also might have to take the GRE exam or the GMAT exam. That exam costs around 150 pounds or like 15,000 rupees, depending on which one you're appearing for. Or you might not have to take it at all, just like I didn't have to. And keep in mind, this is also the same for the undergrads. You have to appear for the IELTS as well as your SAT exams. SAT costs a little bit less. They cost around like 100 pounds, which is like 10,000 rupees. Again, you might not be required to appear for that at all, so great for you. And then coming on to the application fees. Now, while selecting the universities, I'd say be careful with the university you're choosing, because the application fees alone is very expensive. For LSE, application fees during my time was 80 pounds. There's also a fee waiver for it, so check if your university has a fee waiver. You wouldn't have to pay the application fees at all, so make sure that you have a look on your university website that you're applying to for that. Universities just don't have any application fees. Some of them just don't, so you don't have to pay anything, which is great. Now, moving on to the biggest expense, I'd say the tuition fees. Now, the tuition fees can vary from each university. How much it exactly cost me at LSE is 25,920. When I convert it to Indian rupees, it's around 26,20,000, which is again a really expensive for a degree. I know that. Now, keep in mind that this tuition fees was the same for the home students as well as the overseas students. Now, the home students means people who are already residing in the UK who are citizens here, and overseas students are the ones who are not from the UK. So suppose they're from India or USA or Canada or some other country. But the master's fees for almost all the programs, so home as well as overseas students at LSE, is same. So it costs me the same as it would cost to a home student over here. But keep in mind that during your undergrad, the tuition fees for the home as well as the international students are very different. So I know that for a fact, because it costs around 10,000 or 11,000 pounds for a home student in the UK, and it costs around like 30,000 or 27,000 pounds for an undergrad student from abroad. But I did not have to pay that much because LSE paid more than 50% for me. They paid around 14,000 pounds of tuition fees. So like, make sure that you're checking that your university has some sort of funding. Now, coming on to the visa, because let's be honest, visas cost a lot, especially from the countries who have a weaker passport. So let me just tell you how much I paid. The base fee that you have to pay for a student visa, the base fees is 490 pounds, which equates to around 50,000 Indian rupees. And then on top of that, you have to pay VFS Global some fees. For example, I opted for the super priority visa, which is like you get the visa decision within one entire working day. So I applied today and I got the decision and the visa in hand just the next day, which you don't have to do because I was so short on time. I had to opt for the super priority visa, but you can just go for the basic visa, which just cost you 50,000 rupees. I also opted for the automated callback service, which costed me Indian rupees 235. Document scanning service, which costed me 1200 rupees. The call thing, you just get a call when your visa is ready or when there's an update on your visa. And for the document scanning assistance, they scan all of the documents for you, so you just have to pay like 1200 rupees for that. I just opted for that because it was way easier and I did not want to mess anything up. So they just scan everything for you and send it forward, which is like, I think, simpler. You don't have to choose any of it again. And so the total visa fees, I paid 1,56,745 Indian rupees. And now, coming on to the aeroplane tickets. Now, I got a lot of criticism because I travel business class, but let me just be like brutally honest with you. The plane ticket cost me 1,25,000, which I convert to Great Britain pound would be 1,235 pounds. Now let me be brutally honest here. When I said I come from a middle class family and I travel business class, a lot of people criticize me saying that you're not from a middle class family because you're traveling business class. You know what the economy price was back then? It was 1,10,000 because of the G20, which was happening just during the day I was flying to London. It was better to opt for the business class rather than like paying 1,10,000 for economy. Again, these were for the direct flights because it was my first time traveling alone and to a foreign country. So my parents said it would be better for me, and because I had so much luggage, it would be better if I just fly directly over there, which I agreed with. I also suffer from like a few medical conditions, so it is a bit hard for me in that case. So I just opted like the easier route, I'd say the direct flight. So flying economy, it should cost you around 60,000 with like a one stop or two stop. It might even cost lesser than that. And if you're flying business class, I think it will be more expensive than it cost me, because I believe less people were flying business class during that time and more were flying economy. So the business class flights were a bit less, and I also set alerts on Skyscanner. So whenever it was the cheapest, I got a notification and they only had one ticket for that price, so I just booked that. Now coming on to the items for packing. Now I know a lot of you are coming here from your home country, so you need certain things. If you're coming from India like I was, most people carry like pressure cookers and utensils and spices and all of that. I did not carry most of it, that stuff, because my sister was already living here in the UK. So basically I did not spend anything on my packing. It cost me around 10 to 20,000 Indian rupees or 100 to 200 Great Britain pound for the entire shopping thing. I really did not buy that much. I did not buy any clothes. I just bought like a few ready to eat meal options that I could survive like the first few days. Also obviously require a laptop. So this is the laptop and this is my phone. I did not buy any of these. I had these before I came to LSE. So if you're buying a new mobile or if you're buying a new laptop, the laptop would, if you're buying something like a MacBook, it would cost you around like 1,000 pounds or 1 lakh Indian rupees, and if you're buying an iPhone, it would cost roughly around 50,000 to 1 lakh or even more depending on which one you're buying. I would suggest getting a laptop which functions well, because you basically have to do everything on your laptop. So I would recommend investing a bit more money in your laptop and like maybe getting a cheaper phone. I also wanted to buy a GoPro, which cost me 500 pounds, but I did not buy that because I was really out of money. I did not buy that stuff. So moving on to the living expenses, how much do I actually pay while living here? This is my flat, which I live in. It's a studio flat. So I have to pay 1,525 pounds per month for this flat. This is just a studio flat. And the best thing is that it contains all of the bills, like the bills are included in it. So I don't have to pay for Wi-Fi, electricity, gas, or I don't even have to pay for like any of the amenities. There's like gym included, and there's also podcast room, green screen rooms and everything. So it's basically like a serviced apartment, I'd say. Not really, but yeah, sort of. Again, don't ask me where I live because I won't be able to share my personal details on the internet with you. But I would suggest looking into the newer buildings like this one if you want to. I mean, you could also get a flat for, shared flat for around 800 pounds in London. Someone asked me if you could get like a 500 pound room in London, and I said no, because that's just not possible. In like London is very expensive unless you're living like with your relative and they charge you less. 500 pounds, I don't think you'll be able to even find like a bathroom to live in, because I searched up stuff and they were like literally bathrooms, and they were renting it out for like 1,000 pounds. I'm not kidding about this. I checked it online. And then I also pay the guarantor. So for example, if you're an international student in the UK, you either have to pay the entire sum of 12 months in advance. So if I were here, I had to pay 1,525 into 12 in advance to the landlords. But you can also go for a guarantor service, because if you don't choose the option of paying upfront, you have to go for a guarantor. Someone, if you know someone from the UK already, they can be your guarantor. They just have to sign a few documents, but I did not know anyone. So what I did was I took like help from their service, which just gives you the guarantee in exchange for a fee. So I chose Housing Hand, and it costs me 62 pounds per month just for like their guarantee that I will pay the rent. That's it. It's a weird rule, I know, but you have to do it as an international student. And then coming on to the travel expenses, how much I spend every single day. So at first when I arrived here, I did not have a rail card, so I had to pay somewhere between 10 to 12 pounds per day from here to the university and back from the university to here. Again, if you live closer to the university, you don't have to like pay transportation at all. My university is in central London and it is like very expensive. So I could not find an apartment like this for the budget that I wanted to. And after arriving here, I got an Oyster card, which cost me £7. Now Oyster card is basically like a Delhi Metro card. You can travel with an Oyster card in London only. So you can use it in buses, trams, trains, tubes. I believe London Overground as well. So yeah, it works everywhere. And I also bought a rail card. Now a rail card gives you, as a student, if you are aged between 16 to 25, you can get a discount of 30%. It cost me £30 for a rail card. And then on every single journey that I take, it saves me 30%. So with the rail card, it costs me £5.20 for a return ticket. Previously, it was costing me £12 for the same. So I'd say it's definitely like a bargain if you're traveling off peak. And if I'm traveling peak hours, it'll cost me the same. It'll cost me £6 for one way. And the best part is you can also combine your rail card, which is like the train card, with your Oyster card. Once you combine, you can get a discount on everything. So you can get a discount on the trains or tubes, which is like the underground metro, and then the London Overground, as well as buses, trams. So you basically get a 30% off on everything if you combine your rail card with your Oyster card. So that is like a very great tip which I would suggest. If you're moving to London, you do that. And lastly, moving on to the food expenses. Now, groceries can sometimes be expensive, but they aren't usually that expensive. It depends on which store you're buying from. I just summarized the stores for you. The most expensive one is Waitrose, then Sainsbury, then Tesco, then it's Asda, Aldi and Lidl. So you just like get your groceries from this. Like, it's very cheap, I'd say. So it costs me roughly around £50 per month for entire grocery.
Sorry, my camera ran out of battery, so I'm just filming on my phone for the remaining things. I'm in my university, I buy lunch. Now, I won't suggest doing that. If you want to save money, don't be like me. Like, take your own lunch if you can. I'm a horrible cook, so I don't cook and I don't take my lunch. It costs me somewhere around £2 to £7 each day whenever I'm buying the lunch. I don't buy it every day because I don't have to be there in the university for that long anyways. Tuesday, on only one date. On Tuesday, I have to be there for that long. And on Thursday, I have my lunch and then go to the university, so I don't have to have it. Another, like, saver tip. If you are someone who loves to drink chai, coffee, or hot chocolate like I do, then you should get yourself a subscription from Pret. Now, Pret is a really famous lunch here in the UK, and I bought a subscription for it. The first month, it cost me £10 as a student, like with the student discount, and I get 5 drinks every single day. You can get 5 drinks every single day and a 20% off on all of their food items. But the drinks have to be in an interval of like 30 minutes, so I can get a drink, barista made drink, once, and then I have to wait 30 minutes, get another one, and then wait 30 minutes, get another one. But you can get 5 in one day. It's a bargain. And then for the, without the student discount, the first month costs you £15, and the remaining months, if you renew your subscription, will cost you £30, which I don't think it is that bad if you are someone who loves coffee. And then there are also some like miscellaneous expenses, which means if I'm traveling, going around, seeing places, eating outside, ordering in, getting pizzas delivered to my house, it costs me £100 every month. Now, I don't think it really costs me that much because I usually just go to like free places. And lastly, coming to the books. So if you're moving to like study abroad, you would obviously need books, right? Now, guess how much I have to pay for my books? Nothing. I don't have to pay anything because LSE has a huge library and they provide everything for free online, as well as you can go to the library to study if you want like a physical copy of the book. But usually they just upload everything online. You can visit the online LSE library and read everything for free. Great, we're over with this video. So I hope that you all got to know how much it actually costs for a degree in the UK. Like for a master's degree, it would roughly be the same for undergrad, x like 3 or 4, depends on how long your degree is. I'll make a separate video on accommodation in the coming weeks, along with how to perfect your CV, how to write your cover letters, reference, what do you, letter of recommendation, suggestions, and everything in the future videos. Make sure that you subscribe and turn on the notification bell. Don't forget to follow me on Instagram @Samriddhi. and on my study page, which is at Sam Study Station, where I'll be posting more career-related short-form videos, which includes universities which have no tuition fees, or like helpful suggestions which will get you into your dream university, how to make money online as a college student, and very helpful resources for different subjects on how you can ace your exams as well. So make sure that you follow me on Sam Study Station. If you have any question, then make sure that you let me know in the comments and I'll try my best to answer those questions. If you have like a very detailed long query, then you can DM me on Sam Study Station. Now, a note here, I only reply to my followers. So if you're someone who doesn't even follow me and starts asking like a random vague question, I won't answer that. But take care, everyone, and I hope that you all achieve your dreams. I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.